As suggested, my name's Aaron Perry. I work for Alford Hall Monaghan Morris, AHMM. We're an architecture practice and I look after all things digital design. What I want to try and share with you is coming back to one of the slides Ken showed earlier, that spectrum of what we can touch in terms of architecture and that life cycle and how that's been evolved through the last few years. Just one slide on us as a practice. We are an architecture practice, about 530 people or so, have delivered many projects in the City of London and elsewhere. I guess the kind of key thing to suggest is because we're an architecture practice that works from the very beginning, right the way through to construction and handover to clients, we have a unique opportunity to interact with Unreal at all different parts of that process. As an architecture practice, we do actually have an in-house set of visualizers who are responsible for putting together a lot of the media that you're about to see on the next few slides. But to kind of think about that life cycle in terms of very simplistic sections. So convincing the big idea, refining that big idea as a client's brief becomes more developed, demonstrating to that client exactly what they're going to get, and then being able to demonstrate that further and proving our capabilities to future clients and in bids and competitions. Now, whilst it's easy for me to present in this linear fashion, in terms of chronological order, we're kind of newish to Unreal. We started picking it up in 2016 and have sort of jumped around a little bit in terms of this linear life cycle. But to keep it simple, I'm going to start at the very beginning and talk about convincing the big idea. Now, the project I'm going to use to try and demonstrate this is a project we've been assisting Great Portland Estates on and helping them review the acquisition of a very sensitive and high-profile site directly opposite St. Paul's, the BT Centre. And this building is essentially an office building with some retail, but it's this sensitive context, and it's the design iteration that led us into the route of Unreal, and that ability to enhance public realm and align with the City of London policies on enhanced public realm and infrastructure and network road layouts, etc. But why did we explicitly say Unreal? Well, essentially, we had a lot of confidence from other projects that we had been doing in Unreal. We had we took an educated guess that we were pretty confident in the turning that scheme around in quite quick succession, being able to keep up with the rate of change and flux that the client was putting towards us, and also that we were facing from different stakeholders in the project. Probably single most important thing for us was this early ability to test massing. And that sensitive context being in the Unreal environment as well was just such a fundamental thing for us. We were able to establish key views, which is very important when you're trying to build anything next to St. Paul's. And we were able to very quickly switch between the existing condition and any proposals that we were suggesting in context. And as part of this client's well-being agenda, we had the ability in Unreal to bring through realistic flora and fauna, people, traffic, all of those kind of things that in a traditional workflow of static images and traditional ways of us producing visualizations just would not necessarily have been possible. And it wasn't necessarily the big building side, it was also at the macro level. So we were able to have conversations with our client, whether it was CLT versus steel frame, all in that same asset, all in that same digital model. Importantly as well, we were able to have the conversation and go through that journey of walking to the building, into the building, through the building, into the key spaces, and very quickly iterate. So as core designs were changing, we could have all of this information updated. We also had the opportunity to experiment with materiality, colors, panels, glazing, facades, again, updating those key images in a matter of hours as opposed to days as changes were made to the project. And I think finally, for this project specifically, it was that ability to have one single digital media for all reasons, for that scalability of having one single file for all different kinds of journeys with all different stakeholders. Moving a little bit further into that life cycle and beyond the kind of early stage stuff, how do we take that a little bit further once we have a little bit more of a brief? Now, this was actually one of our first projects in terms of our use of Unreal. And it started with a visualizer having a little bit of capacity to test and to innovate. Now, the deliverable was the same as it always had traditionally been. It was static images. And we were able to get some great results at that time. But of course, what changes is you have much more capability with Unreal. So very quickly, static images became more than that. Now, the project used in this example was a Reba competition bid that we won back in 2016 for the Alder Hey Child Bereavement Center. The building itself is an extension to the Alder Hey Children's Hospital in Liverpool, and is essentially a facility for counselors to provide support and bereavement counseling to anybody suffering from the loss of a child. Now, again, static images moved quite quickly into video and to animation, and we built a range of different clips and for all different use cases. We started doing VR critiques and design studies with Paul Monahan, one of our design directors, walking around that building and experience what it would be like. And of course, when you take together all of those static images, those videos, those assets, those VR, all of a sudden we offered something better to our client. We were able to give them a whole host of assets to help them with fundraising. And on a project like this, that was what helped it get off the ground. I'm pleased to say that last week, when it was a little bit sunnier, the roof just went on. So it's great to see that this project has really progressed. Now, looking a little bit forward in that life cycle, but specifically in terms of this project, we also had a fantastic opportunity to spend the time with the counselors. So these are the people that will be delivering the services in this building. And that great opportunity came when they said, we just don't really understand floor plans or sections or images. And we had an amazing opportunity to reuse that data set, that Unreal model that we had been producing, to help them have conversations around fit out and furniture. Taking them on the journey from the front door to where they'll sit and have what is frankly a devastating private phone call with someone, and how can we understand what that will be like in that room and in that space, rather than perhaps just looking at a mood board of different types of furniture. So that helps me nicely start to get into this idea of demonstrating what that building is going to be like as you start to move into it. In this example, I'm going to talk about a project we've done with Derwent, who's one of our long-standing clients. It all started with us doing some design work on the building that we rent from them. They're our landlord for our main office. They sent us a really interesting proposal at the end of that session, saying, could you provide us with all of the marketing material for one of our biggest projects in the office that we were working on with them at the time? Now, that project is Soho Place. You may have just started to see some steel coming out the ground. But Soho Place is a series of two buildings, predominantly office, about 200,000 square feet of office in central London, directly located on top of Tottenham Court Road Tube Station and the brand new Crossrail Station, two of the busiest that will be on the network. There's a public realm in the middle, which is great. And the final challenge there is that there, as you can see in this image, the extract from the Crossrail Station has a series of fans on top. This is a good bit of trivia, which I'll share with you, which make so much noise, it's louder than a Boeing 747 taking off. And we thought it was a really good idea to put a theater, the Astoria Theater that was on the site previously, pretty much on top of that box in a box for acoustics. And it's a really technical project, a really technical challenge. And what I love most about being able to then tell that marketing story for the client is that as the architects, we get to control that from start to finish, which is not typically something we get an opportunity to do. So we had to create a revolving workflow, a revolving loop workflow, from the design models that were being produced in Revit and being tweaked and updated, right the way through to the visualizer's assets in 3ds Max and through Datasmith and into Unreal. Now, that at first was a bit of a challenge. We didn't really have a brief from our client, so we were experimenting with ideas around VR and walking through the building, fixed cameras on tracks moving around and using physical controllers. And there was kind of debate with the marketing agents about how is the best way to effectively share that with prospective tenants. The point was, we had utter confidence, based on our use with Unreal, that whatever those deliverables would eventually be, we knew we could achieve them with Unreal. So some of the end results were some videos and static images. Some of the videos were shown on 4K. Two-story high projections, laser projectors, the same ones you get in the cinemas, custom apps running on 4K touchscreens. It was a really interesting opportunity for us as architects who'd never done any of this stuff before. Now, to give you a bit of a tease, I've just taken some of the video to show with you. So again, these are the projects, amazing work done by the team that put these together. I know that's very biased to say, but we'd never done anything like this before, so we're very proud of that. But we're able to work with the marketing agents to basically tell different stories. Now, one of the primary stories they wanted us to share was that journey from platform to desk. Given the location of the building, that's a big selling point, of course, and that's something they wanted to try and tell. So we were moving these cameras around two or three times a week, but it was no extra effort from us. There was no going back to the beginning and starting all over again. We got to tell the journey of moving through these glazed lift cores right the way up through the building. Different tenants had different ideas about what they wanted to do with their spaces, whether it's just a standard fit out, professional, creative layouts. We could manage design options in that same file without having to redo anything. And whilst we focus on the macro detail of the building, we were also able to tell a bigger story about the location of the building to the city, only achievable in Unreal. In terms of the application, and again, we were architects, we'd kind of never done this before, a custom app was built, and it was about being able to control the information. So the tenants were really interested in being able to kind of move backwards and forwards in terms of what we were sharing. So we were able to demonstrate key spaces, we were able to move the video back and forward. Because it was a touchscreen, we were able to use the panoramics so that the clients and tenants could actually move around and have discussion about space. And compared to your standard marketing brochure, it was a real eye-opener for the client and allowed us to build a much more deeper and richer relationship with Derwin, the client on this project. Which kind of nicely takes me to this next bit. How do our other clients understand, beyond Derwin, what we are possibly capable of? And that's where it comes about being able to prove our capabilities. Now, traditionally, we've done that using static images. One of our directors would do a series of slideshows on presentations based on some drawings or some images. And that's great, but it was always missing something. It was always missing that ability for us to talk about that building in context to its neighbor or the surrounding area. It didn't quite give us the ability to jump from one side of town to the other. So we've recently embarked on a project. We've limited it in this clip to Old Street, Clerkenwell, Farringdon. And we're playing around with the idea of bringing in all of our mapping data into a single Unreal project. Some of the graphics and the user interface we're playing around with in terms of buildings we've worked on or are currently developing, right the way through to actually physically loading in the actual buildings for the Bower and the White Collar Factory, which is right on Old Street. We can jump from one side of London to the other. We can go down to the macro level of looking at a lobby or looking at a core design or facade, and you can analyze this building against others. We can build animations, we can build parts of user interface, and this is something we'll continue to develop over the next 2 years. But I think that's a great way of kind of closing that loop. It's the ability to then show to new clients where we're trying to convince them of a big idea based on proving to them what we are capable of already. And for us, that's all of our benefits that we're taking away from Unreal. That ability of changing our aspirations as we started using it. It started with a couple of videos and a couple of clips. And we don't really know where the limitation is at this point. We want to keep pushing ourselves. We have that increased confidence. We have amazing value and return on investment of the time and efforts we've put into this process. And fundamentally changing our business model. We're able to offer things we were never able to do previously. And that's such an impressive way for us to talk back with our clients and demonstrate our competency. Thank you very much for listening.